Hello guys, in today's video we're going to start the Can't Fear Your Own World Chapter 2. In this video we're going to see Shuhei went to visit the Shiba household to conduct an interview. So without further ado, let's start the video. Several days later, Rukongai. Hisagi Shuhei is engaged in two different occupations at the same time. One of those occupations is his professional duties as Squad 9 vice captain, which everyone knows. The other is being the editor-in-chief of the Seireitei Communication. Seireitei Communication is a public institution magazine which is circulated throughout Seireitei and occasionally as far as some parts of the Rukongai. It is basically under the management of the 9th Division. Naturally, it ought to be treated as equal occupations, but because the nature of the work differs too greatly from primary Shinigami duties, it was, in effect, perceived by society as something akin to a side job. Until a few hundred years ago, this was a simple proclamation issued to the general public which could be referred to as tile block print, but from the period when Tosin Kaname became captain, that format would come to develop rapidly in accordance with the printing techniques of the human world. Perhaps due to Tosin's serious disposition, the captain himself began serving as an editor. It was now being spread throughout Seireitei as one large informational magazine, published with many running stories, or essays and novels and so forth, penned by the captains themselves. After Tosin had left Seoul Society, Hisagi, who was his vice-captain, became responsible for that role. By all rights, Muguruma Kensei, who had returned to his post as captain, should have been the one to become editor-in-chief, but the man himself entrusted all the decision-making to Hisagi, saying, "During my time, I left it up to the troops. Frankly, it just doesn't suit me." Even now Hisagi continues editorial duties as the responsible editor. So, the editor-in-chief of Seireitei Communication has come all the way out here, what can he possibly want with me? The quizzical voice of a woman resounded from the doorway of a certain residence. "What do you mean? I'm collecting information for an article, of course." The other party whom Hisagi replied to is Shiba Kukaku, a pyrotechnician who could be described as a person of clear influence within the vast expanse of the Rukongai. "What is it? Is it about my new object art? I give up. Geez, it's not meant to be an exhibition, you know." With a boastful expression that was contradictory to her words, she shifted her attention to the item of artwork, stone statues holding up a banner which Hisagi had just passed under a moment ago. Two huge statues imitating stern-looking men stood side by side. They held up a banner with the words "Welcome to Shiba Kukaku's residence" painted on it, whilst striking an odd pose. "No, I mean, it certainly became a popular topic of conversation among some people. In that case, I suppose you want to use it for the front cover in the next issue of Seireitei Communication? Well, I'll just make a note of that proposal for now." Having returned an innocuous reply, Shuhei begins to broach the real issue at hand, almost like he was half dodging the subject. "I would like Kukaku-san's cooperation in documenting a memoir of the protection of the Seoul King Great War." "Huh? A memoir, you say? Hasn't it only been, like, half a year since then?" "That's precisely why, you see, I want to keep an accurate record now, while I still have the chance." Shiba Kukaku is both a pyrotechnist on the surface as well as behind the scenes. All involvement with Squad Zero and such were declared side jobs. It is for this reason that there exists a curious big shot like air about her. Even if Hisagi, as vice captain of Squad 9, ranked higher in terms of station, many among the vice captains view her with a sense of respect. In fact, although they are currently a fallen house, the Shiba clan is a respectable family that once produced a number of seated officers and captain ranks. They were a family of good social standing to the degree that they were known as one of the five great noble clans alongside the likes of the Kachiki and Shihoin clans. For that matter, Shiba Kukaku herself, who is standing before him, is also a considerably powerful person. He has heard that she struck down one of the mighty gatekeepers of the Seireitei with Kido alone. In Hisagi's eyes, she wasn't merely a pyrotechnician, but a figure of great influence hidden in the depths of Seoul society. That he had called on such a woman, it was for the purpose of obtaining an interview on behalf of Seireitei Communication, just as he described. Although Seireitei Communication has currently suspended publication due to problems with its publishing systems, a small circulation of a simplified version is being distributed in various places in order to extensively report on the state of post-war reconstruction to the general public. With the target of officially getting it back into print on the first anniversary of the post-war period, it was gradually gaining a secure foothold. Then, in anticipation for the upcoming first reissue, he started receiving requests from many readers asking for details regarding the protection of the Seoul King Great War, to be addressed in his own segment called "Teach Me. Shuhei Sensei. Teach Me. Shuhei-sensei, has featured in Seireitei communication for a long time. It is a page for his project in which Shuhei answers the questions of the readers. Nevertheless, its popularity is shaky, and although it may be revived whenever there is demand, it is an unstable project which is often discontinued after only a few runs following its resumption. Even so, the people of the Seireitei still had yet to grasp the full picture surrounding the war. It seems they were seized by a sense of anxiety about whether or not the war had truly ended, or whether such a thing would never happen again, and they looked to the public institution magazine, the Seireitei Communication, to dispel those fears. In fact, not limited to Teach Me. Shuhei-sensei, the standpoint of many with regard to the magazine itself is a desire to receive an explanation detailing all the particulars of the war, and Shuhei has decided to handle it all as a necessity for his own column. This is a huge task imposed upon Seireitei Communication. It couldn't all be left up to the ordinary squad members. Given that the form is a comeback series of Teach Me, Shuhei-sensei, which coincides with the first reissue of Seireitei Communication, it is he who must clutch the reins of information himself. With that kind of motivation spurring him on, Hisagi had spent his days running around to personally interview the likes of the Visuals Department, the Department of Research and Development, and Squad 4's Special Relief Team, but he did not gather as much information as he had initially expected. It seems there was virtually no one who was able to observe the entirety of the war from a bird's eye view. Just how many people's stories would he have to piece together before getting any closer to its domain? Such misgivings crossed Hisagi's mind. The man who presumably had the most extensive view of the battlefield, Yahaba, had already been buried at the hands of Kurosaki Ichigo. That being the case, he would have no choice but to take it upon himself to pick up and assemble the pieces of war. If it could be spread far and wide, how the Shinigami battled and triumphed in various places, then it's bound to become hope for the people who were dealing with the restoration efforts. The Soul Society has now entered a new battle known as post-war recovery. It is during such times that people simply desire information which is able to put them at ease. In other words, it's what you'd call a battle that only I can fight from here onward. In response to Hisagi, who had explained the situation, after getting himself all fired up, Kukaku returned an answer as she folded her arms. I'm sorry to break it to you, even when you're sparkling those rugged Sanpaku eyes at me, but there's hardly anything I'm able to speak of, you know? I mean, all I did was launch up that lot from Squad Zero along with Ichigo's group. It was a coarse manner of speaking belonging to a woman of mannish character, yet an oddly firm tone of voice. With that alone, Hisagi had somehow or other come to the conclusion that yeah, I guess this truly is a matter she can hardly comment on. Rather than being unwilling to speak of the past, she merely exudes a sort of atmosphere which accepted it all as part of everyday life, thinking I did what I had to do. Well, I guess that means I'll just be giving you my greetings for today, I'll visit another time. It's nothing but a bother if you plan to keep coming back, and it makes no sense for me to even have a right to say anything about you Shinigami and your squabbles. If you want a story, then ask my younger brother Ganju. That guy marched all the way up to the Soul King Palace together with Ichigo and his gang. I suppose he'd be able to tell you at least something. He went up to the Soul King Palace? Speaking of Shiba Ganju, he is the man who once appeared as a Ryoka along with Ichigo and the others during the time of Kachiki Rukia's execution scandal. Why did a man from Rukangai go up to the Soul King Palace? Having been decommissioned from the front lines at the final stage of the war, this is the first time Hisagi is hearing of this fact. Come to think of it, I still haven't covered what happened around Kurosaki and his group. Naturally, Ichigo's group, who were the most deeply involved by the end of the war, should probably be interviewed. However, they are inhabitants of the human world, not Soul Society. In order to travel expressly to the human world for interviews, he must obtain the permission of the Captain Commander. I think I'll be able to receive the Captain Commander's permission, but I wonder if Kurosaki would give his full cooperation in this sort of thing. I can't see that guy talking about himself in much detail at all. As he considered questioning Inoue or Sato about the subject when the need arose, both of whom apparently reside in Ichigo's neighborhood, Hisagi decided to leave the Shiba residence for now. Understood, then I'll listen to what your younger brother has to say first. All right, if you want Ganju, he's probably mounted on his wild boar, wandering around West Rukangai again. Even if you do a half-assed job of looking for him, I think you'd be able to find him right away. He's a loud moron, so you should be able to recognize him at a single glance. Right, it's okay though, I've caught sight of his face every now and then whenever a disturbance occurs. Having received the advice on this dynamic manhunt, Hisagi bows to Kukaku before leaving the house equipped with a fireworks launch pad. Then, when he came closer to his vehicle, which was parked a little further up the roadside, Hisagi noticed something. A few men had gathered around that vehicle which Hisagi had gone to the trouble of ordering from the human world after it had undergone Russification. And, he also noticed, that these men carry within them a Ryatsu so dense, that they could not be mistaken for any ordinary inhabitant of Rukongai. On top of that, the nature of the Ryatsu is different to that of a Shinigami's or Quincy's. What? Why is there a Kawasaki Z2 in a place like this? At the words of the man who had swept back hair that extended around his shoulders, the tall figure of a young man who was standing beside him shrugged. Who knows? What stood before the men's eyes is a motorbike originating from the human world and characterized by its deep crimson paintwork. And this is where we stop the video. Who are those people that has strange Ryatsu and gathered around on the vehicle of Shuhei? Find out on the part 2 of chapter 2 of the Bleach light novel. See you.